Welcome, everybody, to the Allegheny Health Network Online Robotics, Artificial Intelligence, Augmented Reality, and Big Data in the OR course, which we are presenting in conjunction with OTW Broadcasting. Our faculty tonight is truly exceptional, and our course will review the future of artificial intelligence and robotics, uses of AI, augmented reality and robotics in spine surgery, current concepts in virtual reality training, big data in medicine, and finally, AI and robotics reimbursement. Our first presenter is Dr. Gabe Haboub with the Cleveland Clinic, where he specializes in neurological surgery. His topic tonight is artificial intelligence and robotics in 5 years.
Well, thank you very much for having me. My name is Gabe Haboub. I'm the Artificial Intelligence Lead at the Cleveland Clinic Continuous Improvement. I'm also a spine surgeon at the Cleveland Clinic. So the talk I'll be giving today is on the role of artificial intelligence in the future of robotics over the next 5 years. My only disclosure is I'm working on kind of a provisional patent for in this domain, basically. Really, I divided the content for this talk into three components. The first is talking about what is the robotic system? And two is what is sensor fusion? And three, how can we plan action using artificial intelligence? So the way I think about robotic system is basically a brain that connects inputs and outputs. So on the left side here of the figure, we can see an input that could be some sort of navigation system or computer vision that then feeds into a brain, which in turn performs some sort of actions in this situation, screws. Sensor fusion is combining multiple inputs to help with understanding the surrounding environment. These inputs could be a manual input from the operator, input from accelerometer or gyroscope, navigation system, ultrasound, tactile, or even computer vision. So why do we need sensor fusion? So let's imagine we have a robot that's connected to a navigation system. And the robot wants to travel some sort of distance. So when it's close to the navigation reference point, it's very certain of where it is. And it's probably correct. Now, as the robot travels from the reference frame, your robot becomes less certain about where they are in relation to that reference point. And that only increases with time, as you can see here, that uncertainty where the robot thinks is, we're now reaching 10, is actually 9.2. And this, again, growing here as it gets further away from the sensory input. So how can we fix this? So utilizing sensor fusion would help here. For example, by adding an additional sensor, and here is computer vision, the robot recognizing a tree close to the robot, and that tree is referenced to the point 10, and then the robot will adjust the perception of their location to a more closer to reality. What about planning an action with artificial intelligence? So artificial intelligence really helps create logic when it's difficult to expressively write one. And really there are three main learning algorithms in artificial intelligence. There's supervised machine learning, unsupervised machine learning, and reinforcement learning. In this talk, we'll focus on reinforcement learning and we'll see how it will help us make decisions. So all goes back in 2016 on the reemergence of reinforcement learning. So an algorithm called AlphaGo won over the world champion Lee Sedol in the game of Go. And that game is very complex and more complex than chess. So the potential action search space for that game is 10^10^48. So something unimaginable. something that a computer will not be able to handle. So we have to go around that complexity to find some sort of optimal solution. And that algorithm kept growing and growing, and mostly in the world of gaming, where we see a very strong performance without hard coding any complex logic. That also included Atari games. So the way reinforcement learning works is we have an agent, a robot here, that interacts with an environment through some sort of actions. The environment gives some information about what's happening here through some sort of navigation and computer vision. And the way it gives that information is through either tell us where we are through the navigation or the computer vision, or some sort of a reward. So if the agent perform a good action, we'll get be rewarded positively, and get perform a bad action, it will be punished. A good analogy here is screws placement. So if the screws place the pedicle screw position breach the pedicle, then the agent will be punished. Otherwise, you'll get a positive reward. And that algorithm can be expanded to any sort of actions. Here, picking yellow bananas, competitively playing ping pong, where these two algorithms are competing against each other. And really, all these examples carry the idea of rewards, and where the algorithm is just performing action and either getting rewarded or punished. We do not need to specify moving up, right, left, or down. And all I need to do is perform the right combination of action or whatever the algorithm thinks of. So we carried on this logic into an algorithm. So here what we have is basically a simulation environment where we can train such an algorithm and then push that algorithm after being trained to a physical robot. And if you follow that algorithm with time and training, it actually learns. So if you top figure, you can see the cumulative reward that the robot is learning with time is increasing. So let's see here. So basically this robot goal is chase a randomly positioned ball that changed with time. And the goal for this robot is to touch that ball with its tip. Now in the top video, you can see after 20,000 action, the robot's clueless. And after 150 million actions, the video below, the performance significantly improved. So in summary, the way I think about the future of robotics is better sensors to measure the environments, better actuators to perform the desired job, and a smarter brain to handle all the sensors and the actuators. And thank you. I'll lead now to questions.
Thank you, Gabe. That was a great way to kick us off into the future of robotics. Next, we have Dr. Nicholas Theodore, who is director of the Neurological Spine Program, as well as the director of Complex Spine Fellowship Program at Johns Hopkins University, where he specializes in minimally invasive spine surgery. Nicholas, thank you for joining us today.
Good afternoon, and it's a pleasure to be here with you today. And I'd like to thank Dr. Chang for the invitation to address you all. What we're going to talk about is robotics and spinal surgery, where we are now and where we're going to be going in the future. These are my disclosures, some of which are relevant to this talk. when we look at the evolution of spine surgery, it really is linked very closely to navigation and imaging. And we go back over 100 years to Rankin and the discovery of the X-ray and Dandy here at Johns Hopkins with pneumoencephalography. We realized that being able to see where we are and where we need to be was a critical part of what we do. It wasn't until the 1970s that we really got a big boost with MR and CT. And as you look at these, the ones with the yellow star, these are all Nobel Prize winning developments. So spine has benefited from certainly the ability to visualize the spine in multiple dimensions, the soft tissue and the bony anatomy. The next big innovation really came in the 1980s with the advent of stereotaxy and the ability to see where we were in three dimensions. And this is Watanabe with a arm attached to the table, being able to localize and navigate the brain. And this really transformed everything because at this point, there really is no procedure that's done in brain surgery that is not using stereotactic navigation. And what are we looking for in spine surgery? We're really looking for high accuracy and high precision. We want to be able to hit that mark every time. When we look at how we're doing today, and this is a meta-analysis, so it's just published a few years ago, looking at conventional accuracy, freehand versus fluoroscopy and then 3D navigation, we really are so much better with the advent of technology. So freehand, we're about 68% accurate, getting up into 2D fluoro, and then utilizing 3D navigation, bringing us up to 95%. So the question is, why isn't that happening? Why aren't we using that? Well, the reality is that the technology was complex and cumbersome, and I think we lost an entire generation of surgeons. Roger Hartle published this article. Up to 2013, only about 13% of the surgeons were utilizing image guidance because it was difficult to use. Today, we're really in a golden era. We've had increases and advances in imaging and surgery and robotics. And image-guided surgery, again, in neurosurgery, is not going anywhere. Every brain operation utilizes that. Surgery and robotics with the advent of devices such as the Da Vinci have brought the robot into the operating room. And really now I think the trifecta of image-guided surgical robotics is here. And this is what will change the field of spine surgery. When we look back to the first surgical robot, this was the Puma, which was designed to triangulate and allow us to put in a small electrode into the brain. RoboDoc came out of Johns Hopkins, which was the first commercial robot to aid in the coring of the femoral shaft. And then came the Da Vinci, which was really devised for telerobotic surgery. And this came out through the military with the thought of being able to navigate and operate from a distance. And this has really changed the soft tissue surgery for the general surgeon and obstetrician who use these devices. When we look at spine surgery, the question really is, why would we adopt this? Why do we want this technology? Well, so surgeons, we're looking to capture patients. Patients are talking about less invasive surgery. That's really the banter that we see. We would like to reduce radiation exposure to ourselves and our patients. And ultimately, we want to be able to plan and do things with consistency, which we don't have right now. When we look at radiation risk, it's horrible. When we talk about MIS surgery and taking an X-ray machine into the operating room, we are exposed to inordinate amounts of radiation. And, you know, this study from Italy showed a 5 times risk of radiation exposure. Even utilizing lead shielding only protects us about 66% of the time. This is me this year, finally, after 20 years, throwing away the lead. I'm not exposing myself anymore. So I first started looking into this about 20 years ago and looking at designing a robot that used image guidance. And that was the key in my mind. So how do we use image guidance in real time to help us guide a robot? And, you know, we were putting this together in Phoenix. This is Neil Crawford. And the reality is the whole idea was, can we target a pedicle? Can I put a K-wire into a pedicle utilizing robotic guidance? And this is the first sort of iteration back in 2012. And we realized that it can be done. So we can take a preoperative CT and merge it to the patient and allow us to navigate in real time. And ultimately now, there are multiple robots available to us to help us in this space, utilizing image guidance and robotics. The real-time ability for feedback is critical when you talk about image guidance. So it's not just about putting the screw in. In this case, it's about taking the tumor out and about being able to navigate. So understanding that the marriage between these two technologies makes them both more powerful than they are alone. And being able to plan, whether you're just using fluoroscopy or preoperative CT or intraoperative CT, gives us the ability to have an understanding of what we're doing before we're in the operating room. We're no longer flying by the seat of our pants. And what we're looking for is some feedback in surgery. We need to know, are we accurate? Is our surveillance intact? How much force are we applying? The planning in these iterations is actually quite easy, and we can actually change that planning. We can actually change planning of pedicle screws as we do them, as we're putting them in, to be able to get the proper trajectory. Then positioning the robot is quite easy, bringing the robot into the field draped. Our residents worried about the robot taking away their role in the surgery, but honestly, the robot is off to the side and everybody still has a seat at the table. Placing screws now, we're down to the point where I'm putting in four pedicle screws in less than 5 minutes. I never would have thought this was possible. We're marking the skin, making paramedian incisions, and then literally within 4 to 5 minutes, putting in four pedicle screws for an MIST lift. This is transforming the field. I'm now putting these screws in through small incisions with the robot in very short order time, putting a retractor in, then doing the T-lift. And the reality is that it's not just for MIS cases. We can do it for open cases as well. But the usage of robotics is showing us that we can shrink down the size of the procedure. This is a woman I operated on last year who had this deformity here from osteomyelitis. And again, being able to put in screws, the top and bottom percutaneously, saved a lot of blood loss and time. And then in doing the cage reconstruction in the middle. This is a patient in whom we did a vertebral column shortening for lipomyelomeningocele. What you see here are very small pedicles. Hitting these freehand would be very difficult. With the usage of the robot, we get pedicle expansion. It allows us to use corridors in a very precise and accurate manner. And then a case like this, a morbidly obese individual with ankylosing spondylitis, BMI of 50, being able to fixate this fracture in under an hour with only 50 cc's of blood loss. And oh, by the way, as a Jehovah's Witness, obviously, these can be harrowing cases because the blood loss is what can set, you know, be the difference between life and death. This has changed the paradigm of how I'm doing surgery now. Tumor surgery as well, a hybrid case where we're going through the fascia, you know, putting the screws in and then doing a decompression of the spinal cord. It also now has ushered in a new era of accuracy because now it's not just are we in the bone, but since we have a plan, we can see how we did overlying plan in place. And not everything is perfect. We learned early on that there was some deflection of the tip, as you can see in D and G, where things are sort of parallel. And the reality is now with new drill techniques, we've seen that almost disappear from an accuracy standpoint. Accuracy continues to improve. We just published this year looking at three-dimensional accuracy of how we can volumetrically assess our accuracy. And this has been quite exciting. And the accuracy is much, much better than it is freehand, for sure. We did a study also looking at the learning curve. And there's a learning curve associated with all technologies. So we matched 28 patients with 56 controls. We really didn't find any difference in blood loss or length of stay. But what we found was that over the course of time, about 4.5 minutes procedure savings as we learn how to use the technology. And now we're now reliably under 2 hours for an MIS case. Ultimately, what I think we're going to see is a marriage between robotics and different imaging modalities as we go around the body and utilize image-guided robotic surgery. Being able to know hardware, we're working on this in the lab right now, to be able to erase artifact from hardware. This is something that's going to be very cool that will be coming out soon. Automatic pedicle screw planning and augmented reality now, being able to superimpose in under direct vision exists right now with various technologies, which is very exciting. Planning again, automatic pedicle screws we're able to do. And then ultimately the last thing where this will bring us is an artificial intelligence paradigm of where we can take all of these modalities, imaging, patient demographics, patient reported outcomes, and bring them together to inform us on who's a good surgical candidate, who needs surgery, and how we can predict our outcomes before we perform a procedure. Ultimately, technology really has been a critical part of spine surgery, and there's a learning curve with everything. I think ultimately, as we go forward and more people become familiar with this technology, you realize that this is going to become part and parcel of what we do. I don't think we're going backwards anytime soon. I'd like to thank the organizers for their time and attention and the ability to address you all today, and hope to see you all soon in person. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing that with us, Nicholas. Presenting next, we have Robin Young, who I'm sure all of you know as the CEO of RRY Publications and editor of Orthopedics This Week. Robin has worked on Wall Street for over 25 years as a medical analyst and will be presenting today on big data in medicine. Robin?
Thank you, Boyle. My topic today is big data in medicine. This is going to be a primer. Details are available in different talks later on. Medicine is generating about a quintillion. Don't ask me how much is a quintillion. A quintillion bytes of data every day. And the promise of big data is that it will tease out of that ocean of data transformative insights about patient care and disease treatment. Now, let's begin by defining our terms. Big data is shorthand for any information system that can only have predictive value by using extremely large data sets. It relies on the law of large numbers. So if you take one dice, roll it, the odds you're going to hit a number one are 16.7%. You can roll that dice 10 times and never hit a one. But if you roll that dice 1,000 times and it's a fair six-sided dice, the likelihood that number one comes up is 16.7% exactly. It's highly predictable and it's empirically demonstrable. Given a large enough N, many apparently random phenomena become highly predictable. And that's the law of large numbers. Our industries are based on this: insurance, retirement, Las Vegas. Medicine, however, laughs at big data systems because medicine requires logarithmically more data than any of these other ones. It's because we are now entering an era where the tools are available to transform these oceans of data into insights that we're even talking about big data in medicine. So all medicine is an explicit or implicit prediction, or as we more commonly refer to, predictive value, namely p-value. And every pharmaceutical, biologic, device goes through the regulatory review in order to establish that base level of efficacy predictability and safety predictability. Big data's value lies in its potential to improve the predictability of diagnosis and treatment. For example, you may tell your patient that they have an 80% chance of 75% pain reduction, and you have a 95% confidence level that that is the case. Big data will move those numbers up. Here are some of the basic applications where big data is already playing a role. And I'm going to start by going over a couple of these applications: patient care and marketing. This is where big data currently is having its most advanced impact. This is a way to manage and bundle the doctor-patient engagement process, and it effectively standardizes and presumably improves the accuracy and precision. Mercy Health out of Chesterfield, Missouri, tested a big data system with an artificial intelligence algorithm to develop care pathways, and they use their own data to develop those care pathways. They hired a company out of Menlo Park, California, that brought in some of these AI algorithms to help build this, help to find patterns really in the unstructured information that was inside their electronic health systems and their payer records. In the first year of putting this system to work, Mercy Health generated $15.8 million in cost savings, and that's only with 56% of their caregivers using the system, only 56%. The following year, the next year, they generated $20 million of cost savings, and here they had 70% utilization. And here's the kicker: the savings came from reduced variations in care. Image processing. On June 11, 2019, the FDA cleared the first artificial intelligence software program to read, triage, and flag CT images of spine issues. According to the FDA, the system was intended to assist trained radiologists to be more accurate and faster. The system, which is created by Israeli-based ADOC Medical, their time, the artificial intelligence system, had a 3.9-minute time to notification with a 95% confidence rate versus 58.4 minutes, 95% confidence interval for the trained human radiologist. ADOC uses a deep learning algorithm that looks at millions of images to learn, quote, learn the image features. Imaging dependent specialties, of course, include neurosurgery, trauma, and a lot more. And using radiomic big data is going to increase the accuracy and speed of diagnosis. And as you can tell, it's coming in today. Electronic health record management. This is a fact of life, of course, for 90% of all physicians. It's messy, it's ambiguous, the data is complex, it's peppered. All kinds of non-standard terminology, grammatical errors. It's a frustrating fact of life. As these systems have gotten into healthcare, several studies have linked the rise of these EHR systems to physician burnout. Therefore, big data is a logical tool to improve utilization and reduce this burnout. A lot of organizations are piloting big data, artificial intelligence, machine learning programs, such as natural language voice recognition software, neural network algorithms, and advanced text mining systems to automate EHR data input with, importantly, simultaneous error checking. Reimbursement, big data is already affecting reimbursement. In the payer systems, private, public, whether you're talking Medicare, Medicaid, or the top private insurance companies, this is where the biggest repository of patient-specific data resides. Private insurance companies have 154 million patients in their record bases. Medicare and Medicaid, 114 million. The integrated systems like the VA and Kaiser, tens of millions more. Three things that big data is going to be applied to here and is actually occurring now. One is claim adjudication, that's billing and collections, that's expensive, error prone, labor intensive, and here big data is going to transform that. Reducing fraud. Here the algorithms are neural network type algorithms and they're looking for patterns to identify any suspicious claims. They're looking for abnormal price patterns. And then once they spot something that doesn't seem to make sense according to the algorithm, they do a manual investigation. And lastly, as we know, they are profiling physician performance and cost, trying to identify who are the better performing, least expensive physicians, and then making decisions based on that information. Enabling tools. This is my personal favorite area. One of the things that's most interesting are all these sensor-based data gathering devices, you know, the wearables. They check heart rate variability, core temperature, blood oxygen, breathing rates, gait, blood pressure data, all of that. That is creating massive stream of data. Now, a lot of healthcare organizations are on top of that, creating their own data registries simply because they can. Memory is cheap and so forth. Layered on top of that is the coding infrastructure, which itself is changing. The ICD-10 codes, the ICD-10 PCS, we are moving from basically 68,000 codes to 87,000 codes. So think of this like a great big data sandwich. One thing layered on top, the stream of data from sensors, on top of registries, on top of coding. And you are now talking about a tsunami of unstructured, unprocessed textual data. This is going to require a whole suite of powerful cleaning tools, structuring tools, tools that standardize information. This is probably the most valuable section of big data in medicine right now. And the one, in my opinion, is the least the one that people are not looking at as much as they should. Asking why. What if you don't agree? What if you don't agree with the big data generated diagnosis or treatment plan? Can you ask the system why? In 2013, a 16-year-old patient was massively overdosed. The doctor entered the prescription in milligrams, as you would for an adult, into the computer. The computer, however, was programmed to accept dosage in milligrams per kilogram, as you would do with a child. The computer gave the doctor a warning. The doctor ignored the warning because he'd had so many false positive warnings in the past. So the smart system packaged the wrong dosage, the nurse administered the wrong dose, the patient overdosed. According to the Pennsylvania Patient Safety Authority, human-computer interactions were responsible for about 55% of preventative prescription and diagnostic errors. Big data systems perform best when the analysis goal is clearly defined, the data is high quality, and the context is simple. Biased or ambiguous data, garbage in, will create skewed outcomes, garbage out. Facial recognition algorithms, for example, tend to be biased where they were trained. US-based facial recognition software tends to more accurately categorize white men than women or dark-skinned people. Chinese-based facial recognition systems do worse on white faces. Therefore, the ability of the physician to ask the system why is an utterly essential safety net. Risks. Hold on a minute here. There are two primary risks: garbage in, garbage out, which we just discussed, and data privacy. Big data systems have the ability to break down one of the foundations of modern medicine: patient-doctor confidentiality. I won't get into all the details. You can see it on our website, but there have been story after story of malicious break-ins where patient data has been hacked. Now, I want to close with a brief description of putting big data in context. There is a danger we become overly reliant on big data, and I want to illustrate it with this story. In the 1990s, Gregory Chudovsky and his brother, who are pictured here, were the world's greatest living mathematicians, and they built in their Manhattan apartment one of the most powerful supercomputers of their time. They used that to solve pi. Pi, you know, is the ratio of the circle, its circumference to its diameter. There are 3.14 diameters for every circle. It's used in trigonometry, geometry, statistics, thermodynamics, and so forth. It's an infinite number, and yet it's tethered to a basic shape in geometry, a circle. It's a fixed point. Pi does not move. It's the math that wobbles around pi. By mid-1991, the brothers had reached 2 billion digits past the decimal point, double the existing world's record, and they kept hammering away at pi for the rest of that year. At the end of that effort, no pattern emerged. Pi proved to be infinitely long, non-repeating, absolutely, unalterably orderly. In other words, it is both the most perfect random data sequence that has ever been discovered. It's more unpredictable than anything else known to man, but it is not random. The fact that it can be calculated with a formula means it is orderly. In the world of mathematics, any number that is both random and orderly is called transcendental. It combines the appearance of randomness with fundamental orderliness. That is also true of biology. Big data systems rely on correlative patterns in order to attempt to predict natural phenomena. They try to square the biologic circle. With tools like big data, AI, and ML, what we're going to do, we're going to improve our predictability, but we're basically going to keep wobbling back and forth around biology. We're going to go back. It's what we are trying to do, in effect, is a transcendent activity, which I call measuring the fingerprints of God. That is the definition of transcendence. Thank you, everybody. It's a real pleasure to be here. And if you want a copy of the talk, just email me at robin@ryortho.com. And Boyle, thank you, brother. Back to you.
Thank you for that excellent overview, Robin. We're now going to take the first of our two breaks. We'll be resuming our lectures in about 4 minutes. I'm now going to transfer hosting duties over to Dave Briggs, who'll take us out of the lecture hall and introduce our first sponsor for this evening. Dave?
Thank you, Dr. Chang. Our first sponsor is Medtronic, who as a company is leading the way with intelligent and connected patient solutions. For anyone interested in more information about these truly exceptional solutions, please follow the link posted in the Zoom chat function. And back to the lecture hall, Dr. Chang.
Thank you, Dave. Our next faculty member is Dr. Frank Phillips, Director of Minimally Invasive Spine Surgery at the Rush University Medical Center, who will be discussing his work with augmented reality mediated spine surgery. Frank, we're very excited to have you presenting with us again.
Well, thank you, Boyle. My name is Frank Phillips, and I'm excited to be here talking today about augmented reality and spine surgery. The future is now. As you can see, a list of my disclosures, the one that's particularly relevant to this talk is Augmedics, on whose products I'll be talking, and I do consult for the company. So let's start defining different types of reality and how they might or might not apply in the medical space. So virtual reality is a fully immersive artificial environment, much like the artificial reality games people play using computers and iPads. Then augmented reality is a virtual overlay into the real world. So real world is enhanced with digital objects. And then even more contemporary is mixed reality, which are virtual objects anchored within the real world setting. And the user has opportunity to interact with both the real world and the virtual environment. So augmented reality is a technology that essentially integrates digital information into the user's real world environment, which in turn offers a new approach for treatments in medicine. AR can potentially be used to aid in surgical planning and execution. When we think about spine and where these technologies might apply, we think of what the current solutions for minimally invasive spine surgery is. Generally, historically, we've used a lot of fluoroscopy, which results in high radiation to the patient, surgeons, and OR staff, and all the negative sequelae of high doses of fluoroscopy radiation to all of those parties. It also results generally in a less efficient workflow, and putting one or sometimes two C-arms in the operating room is a large OR footprint, making it difficult to work around. We've evolved more recently to navigation and robotics. Both of those are very high capital investments, have large OR footprint. With navigation, there's distraction from the patient with a tension shift where you're looking away from the field to a monitor. It often is not integrated well into the surgical workflow. There's generally a long learning curve, as has been shown, particularly with robotics, with increased OR times early on, sometimes leading to low rates of adoption, and line of sight issues between trackers and markers. Often people move their hand in a certain way, they lose the direct line between the track and the mark, and the navigation image suddenly disappears. And most of these products, or many of them, are often tied to specific implants. So when we could dial into each one of those, navigation is being shown to enhance screw accuracy, and it eliminates radiation for the OR staff versus the patient who's getting essentially a CT scan for navigation. The cons are also the expense. It's generally a more than $1 million investment. It's cumbersome. Attention's paid to the monitor rather than the surgical field. Generally takes up a lot of the OR space. And as we've talked about, line of sight challenges. Moving to robotics, I would contend that what robotics are today is navigation dressed up with an aiming arm, and it's used primarily as an uber expensive marketing ploy. To date, robotics have unproven value despite many of the promises. And this cartoon, I think, captures a lot of this. This robotic technology has been driven by very sophisticated programmers, designers, very skilled engineers. But at the end of the day, does it really provide something that we need or want? So in a perfect world, what do we need to enable MIS surgery? We need to make difficult tasks simple and reproducible. We'd like to eliminate radiation. We want accuracy without a difficult learning curve, because remember, during that learning curve, it's often our patients that are paying the price. We would want 2D and ideally 3D visualization of the spine. We want the technology to enhance, not retard, surgical efficiency. Ideally, it should be implant agnostic. And at the end of the day, the real test is it has to provide value defined as outcome over cost. So what's out there? I'm going to just give you a taste of some of the AR technologies that exist or are almost out there. And then I'll talk about the technology we've been using at Rush. So this is a technology from Brain Lab, and it's essentially based on a microscope that ultimately has a tracking system and converts the microscope image into 2D, 3D imaging. I'm not sure this has been released, and this is more of a technique that's being evolved and being developed, but that's one of the techniques that's out there. Then holosurgical, which I'm proud to say was developed by Chris Seminoff, one of my ex-fellows in University of Illinois in Chicago, essentially, as you see in these images, provides some degree of 3D imaging. It involves arrays in the field, a surgical tool, and still requires a distant tracker, which you see in the top image. That creates 2D imaging and then makes a 3D image, which is projected onto that screen that you see sitting overlying the patient. So certainly a step in the right direction, but still doesn't get by a lot of the limitations of some of the navigation issues we've talked about. So I'm going to talk to you about augmented reality using the augmented system, which we've used at Rush quite extensively over the last year. The focus is all on the surgical field. There's no remote tracking at all. There's no footprint in the OR. You have a retina display headset and a laptop. It provides 3D augmented reality images of the spine and 2D CT navigated images. And this is sort of looking down on the right, what the 3D image might look like intraoperatively with the skin intact. Unfortunately, it's difficult because, you know, obviously by virtue of being on a computer, we're seeing a 2D image, whereas this image would be beautifully displayed in 3D if you're using the system in the patient. So what is X-Vision? You have a headset, which is wireless, so allows free movement within the OR. It's personalized for each customer. It matches your interpupillary distance. There's a built-in surgical tracking system. It's built into the headset, so there's no distant cameras or anywhere outside of the surgical field that the instruments have to talk to or connect to. And it provides 2D and 3D imaging in the surgery. So this is what it looks like in the real live OR. There's absolutely no footprint. It's very intuitive, natural posture and field of view. You're working just as you would if you were doing this without the augmented reality. There's minimal disruption of surgical flow, short learning curve, natural line of sight of the tracking camera, and it's an open platform. So this just gives you a taste of what it looks like with the skin intact. We see full visualization of the patient and the surgical field. And we provided 2D axial sagittal images like you would with any navigation, but also a 3D view of the spine, which is projected directly onto the headset lens and sent on your retina. So with the skin intact, it's like you're looking at the spine laid out in front of you. So here you see what it looks like in the OR. Two headsets. There I am with my fellow. We're both seeing the exact same thing. Easy to teach. We don't have to look away from the field at any time. Our eyes are always focused on the patient. This is the external monitor, which everybody else in the OR is seeing, obviously 2D and not 3D imaging, but gives you a sense of what everyone sees while we're working with the headsets. Is this accurate? We did a study at Rush, presented in Journal of Neurosurgery last year. A lot of screws from the thoracic down to the sacral level. Accuracy in the lumbosacral spine of 100%, in the thoracic 98.2, with the screw tip deviating less than 2 millimeters from plane trajectory and about 1.3 degrees. So this was well within the FDA specifications and resulted in FDA approval. To just kind of wind it up, I'm going to give you the first MIS case we did, and actually the first MIS case ever done with this technology. A 51-year-old female, prior L4-5 fusion a number of years ago, presents with new onset symptoms, back pain, neurogenic symptoms, an MRI showing stenosis at the level above at L3-4 and a spondylolisthesis at the level below at L5-S1. So with this, our plan was to do an all-lateral inner body construct, so a lateral anterior body fusion, a lateral X-lip at L3-4, and then instrumentation, screws prone using augmented reality. So these are some fluoroscopic imaging. That's our lateral ALIF, the patient in the lateral position, essentially doing the exact same ALIF we would with them supine. There you see the cage going in, and without having to reposition, we do our lateral 3-4 X-lift procedure, and there you see cages above and below the old fusion. Then we get into the augmented reality, a small incision with a spinous process reference marker. Here we are going to it. There you see myself and my fellow working. We're looking right down at the surgical field. Here's the 3D visualization, again, on the monitor, not really what we're seeing. And it's interesting, you can see on the 3D, but in 2D image on the right, you see some of the screws we put in. You can actually see the screw holes from the screws we removed to be replaced. You can actually see the fusion mass down there. And it gives you excellent 3D visualization of all of this anatomy. And here again, this is sort of what it looks like as we work through the skin. Yeah, you can see one of the old screws, the trajectory was somewhat lateral. So we're changed it and redirected it using a combination of the 2D and 3D imaging. Yeah, you see just some live footage from the case. And there you see us putting a screw in. And there you see both the 2D navigation images and the 3D images, obviously taken from the monitor, not from our headset, where we'd be seeing all of this in beautiful three dimensions. That's what the intra-op PERC screws look like. And then here's some post-op imaging, which I think looks pretty good. So in conclusion, I think augmented reality is really going to evolve and become a part of what we do. It's accurate. It makes us better surgeons. It's extremely efficient. It flows with the case. It's economically viable. There's no large capital expenses. It probably costs 10% of what a robot would cost, which makes it attractive for alternate environments outside the hospital, like surgery centers. It's transportable. You really just need a headset and a laptop, and you're ready to travel. So if you work out in multiple surgery centers like I do, I can just travel with this. I don't need new equipment everywhere I go. So I think at the end of the day, navigation, robotics, augmented reality, where do they all fit? I think at the end of the day, there's a buffet of technologies that will customize for the appropriate patient, for the appropriate pathology, and the appropriate venue, much like there's a place for relatively simple iPhones versus iPads versus laptops versus desktop. And they're not mutually exclusive. I think we'll choose in which situation any one of these technologies provides the greatest value. I would contend that robots that are currently out there need to be more than $1 million plus aiming devices. And I suspect over time they will and do things that we really need help with. And I think at the end of the day, enabling technologies that enhance accuracy, efficiency, and provide true value will prevail. And with that, I thank you, and I will end off there.
Thank you for that, Frank. Continuing with our topic of adult spinal surgery, we have joining us tonight Dr. Jeff Gumm. Jeff has been with Norton Leatherman Spine Center since 2014 and often presents on his topic of utilization of predictive modeling in spine surgery. Jeff?
Thank you, Boyle. Good talk so far. My name is Jeffrey Gumm from Norton Leatherman Spine Center, Louisville, Kentucky. And I'm going to talk about the value of predictive analytics and applying our value of predictive analytics in ASC and applying predictive models to cost analysis. So an area of interest to me is economics and spine. Here's my disclosures. So predictive modeling has become a real big buzzword as far as risk analysis. And over time, this is evolving and we're becoming more elegant in ways we understand national registries, how to collect data. Overall, big data is really our new currency in spine surgery. And we're striving to collect more granular data and compile data, which is giving us a better evidence-based direction in spine surgery. My perspective today is discussing cost. And so why is cost important? Because it's part of the value equation. Spine surgery, especially ASD, is a huge target for cost reduction because of exponential growth, large variability, and a really expensive surgery. There's a lot of cost containment efforts. These include bundle payment models, appropriate risk sharing with hospital and payer, identifying catastrophic cost outliers. And the question is, does risk stratification really equal cost stratification? So when you look at the value equation, which is really a ratio between outcomes and costs, how do we define cost? There's a lot of different ways we could define cost. And really, this is whose perspective. And really, all are important. It's just what angle you want to take or use the analysis. Societal's perspective, right? The payer's perspective. And what's unique in spine surgery that I've spent a lot of time over the last few years talking about is really the hospital's perspective. So societal perspective is really Medicare allowable rates. That's generalizable. It's standard for cost effectiveness studies. Hospital or payer perspective, that comes from hospital charges. Problem with that, it's not generalizable. It's inflated and it's non-transparent. Then from a hospital perspective, this is actual direct hospital cost. This is difficult to obtain. We find that a lot of centers can't or are not willing to share that because implant pricing and vendor deals, et cetera. But it's definitely a perspective that needs to be considered in spine surgery. Here's a quick case example, right? A T2 to pelvis screw density 2.0, tons of biologics used. But if you do the same case with no biologics, no interbodies, and all hooks and very little screws, that's considered the same, right? If you look at the Medicare allowable rates or the hospital perspective, right? The actual cost is drastically different when you break down a case that uses different components like that. That's why I think the hospital perspective is very important. Here's a paper that we published in 2017 that looked at these different cost value metrics. And what we found is the actual cost compared to Medicare reimbursement was about $18,000 more, right? So the hospital ate $18,000 or 17% on every single deformity case. That's not sustainable. That doesn't make sense long-term for us. If we break down deformity DRG or codes that were dropped for deformities in 2014, and we extrapolate that 18 $1,000 per case, that's about $500 million or $461 million that hospitals ate in deformity care, right? That is not sustainable. That's why we have a big target on our back from a deformity perspective. At our center, we saw that the variable cost per case was creeping up each year, an increase in $500, an increase in $1,000. We also found that the outliers were increasing as well, right? So we were finding that there were more and more outliers over certain thresholds. So two major projects within the ISSG and ESSG over the past 2 to 3 years are looking at catastrophic costs and can we determine a government payment threshold that we could then come under from a cost perspective, on an actual cost perspective. First project, which I'll probably spend the most time on, was published in Spine in 2019. And this is utilization of predictive modeling to determine episode of care costs and to accurately identify catastrophic costs, non-warranty outliers in deformity surgery. So four sites, seven surgeons, mean episode care of cost or index episode of care of cost was about 71,000, right? Mean 90-day cost was 74,000. Difference in that is the revisions that are needed within 90 days. We set a catastrophic cost threshold at $100,000. Pretty easy number to remember. About 12% of those at the index episode of care were above that. Almost 15% of those were above that at 90 days. If we look at the distribution, we could see that the majority of the surgeries fell between that $50,000 and $100,000 threshold. Again, we're using actual direct costs incurred to the hospital, not a proxy like Medicare allowables, not charges. This is actual costs, which is not easy to obtain. If we look at the distribution based on site, you can see some sites were really spread out, large standard deviations. Some sites were pretty tight. Same type of diagram here, looking at the surgeons, right? So some surgeons, very narrow as far as their window of costs, some very wide. We also looked at number of levels fused. As expected, number of levels go up, cost goes up. This pretty linear relationship, nothing surprising there. When we break it down on a year-to-year basis, from a very good perspective, we were starting to ratchet in that standard deviation between yearly costs. So over time, we were being more consistent with the cost of these surgeries. If you look at the revisions and indications, as expected, you know, PJK and pseudoarthrosis are really what drives the most costly revisions. But pseudo was all at 2 years. PJK, the majority of that was actually pretty split between 90 days and 2 years. So now we start to get into some of the interesting components of the study. Right, so this linear regression model that shows that the variables that were important with regards to cost, levels fused, approach, surgeon, length of stay, and if it was a previous revision. Another way to look at it, again, 90-day cost, levels fused, surgical approach, inner body fusion, which makes sense as we're increasing the number of lateral inner bodies we're using. That became a big factor in another way we sliced the data. Again, a random C forced regression at 90 days showed that, again, levels fused, surgeon, inner body approach, length of stay, very common variables that keep popping up regardless of how we dice the data. So overall, in this study, we found that about 12% exceeded that catastrophic cost threshold that we set. Across all the algorithms, the predictors, the most common predictors and strongest predictors were number levels fused, approach, surgeon, inner body fusion, length of stay. What's unique about this is we've done similar studies on outcomes, right? Surgeon has never popped up. All us surgeons think that we're a little unique, a little bit better than the surgeon next to us. And when we look at outcomes across the board within the ISSG, ESSG, very large study groups, surgeon's not really a factor with outcomes, but it is a very important predictor and driver with regards to cost, which makes it unique, right? Another project that we looked at was trying to reach this Medicare allowable threshold in ASD surgery. So we know what Medicare will pay. Is there things that we could do to come in under that threshold, right? So we define costs. We talked about different ways to define that. Can we modify cost? And then what is our cost target? So we use Medicare allowable rates or what the government would pay as our threshold. And the hypothesis of this is there's identifiable, potentially modifiable, and patient-specific factors that predict if these ASD surgeries are below this threshold. Very interesting findings. When we look at this, there is a huge variation with hospitals. Some hospitals meeting this threshold only 6.7%, some 78%, right? What's the difference? The academic centers that we compared were way more likely to meet this threshold. The other thing, if you look at the difference in the bottom chart, the in 96,000 dollars Medicare allowable rate, $78,000 dollars, huge variation. You're talking about 20 some thousand dollars between some of these codes, between what the government would pay and what our actual cost was. If you break these down between different hospital systems, the difference in cost, right? So from the lowest to the highest, you're looking at 56,000 to 78,000, $22,000 difference. Look at the reimbursement. So this is generalizable gold standard for cost effectiveness studies, $40,000 to $91,000. That's over 2x difference. This is what the government pays. Pays hospital four, $91,000, pays hospital one, $40,000, right? The other thing we looked at, when we looked at a predictive model of this, levels fused, specific DRGs, revision, age, and center are all important variables of whether we meet this threshold. Common themes that we're seeing here, levels fused, revision surgery, et cetera. Centers, not necessarily surgeon here, but centers made a big difference of whether we meet this threshold or not. So overall, what we found in this was we could accurately predict meeting this threshold in ASD surgery. About 57%, we increased the likelihood 57% of meeting this threshold if it was done at an academic center. I could explain that further outside of this if people want to discuss that. For revision surgery, there was a 10% increased likelihood of meeting that threshold. In certain DRGs, same thing. Each level we increase, there is a decreased likelihood. That makes sense. We understand that increased levels fuse, less likely to meet this threshold. So overall, what we learned from this cost modeling, we went into this knowing that there was going to be a large variability in actual costs, right? We knew that. What we found that there was also a large variability in the reimbursement from CMS. And this depends on where the center's at. If you have residents, if you're academic, what your surrounding environments like West Coast, East Coast, Midwest, et cetera. We also found that surgeon or center factors were actually more important than patient characteristics. That's really unique to these chain of studies that we've done. Overall, we have to improve the value equation to continue to be able to do ASD surgery. And big data is really going to help guide us in this direction. So I want to give thanks to the ISSG, ESSG, Shay Best, Chris Ames, Ferran Palise. Those guys have really been captains of the ship driving us towards this cost predictive analytics and really how we use and improve the value equation overall. Thank you guys for your time.
Thank you for your presentation, Jeff. Next, we have Dr. Michael Steinmetz, who is also joining us from the Cleveland Clinic, where he is the chairman of the Department of Neurosurgery. His presentation is an overview of the uses of artificial intelligence in the OR. Thank you for being here, Michael.
Thank you, Boyle, and thank you for the invitation to present at this meeting. I'm truly honored. You have a number of content experts who really have expertise in areas of AI and machine learning and will define their use in various areas of spine. And my charge today is, I think, really to provide maybe a broader view of AI and machine learning and how it will help us in spine medicine, not necessarily just spine surgery, but spine medicine. And how it can help us in the value proposition, I think, at least moving forward. So I'm going to try to stay at that higher level view here as we move through it, but I'm going to give you some examples of how we are using AI in our spine center and what we hope to do with it as we move forward into the future. So when we look at AI and machine learning, you know, again, what we're really talking about is a big data approach to these type of problems, right? It's taking a lot of data, analyzing it very quickly and effectively, and applying it to things like predictive analytics and other areas as well, depending on the platform we're using. And this is an interesting quote from Gina Rometty. She was here at the Cleveland Clinic speaking a few years ago, talking about big data, and you can see the quote here where she says, data is the natural resource of the 21st century. And that's really powerful when you think of things like oil and water and what that means to us as humans. And she's using data as an example of that, because I think an area that has the data and can analyze the data is going to be in control and will be the leader moving forward. Now, what's interesting here is data is nothing new, right? We've had data around us at this quantity forever. Why now? You know, why is it now able to be the natural resource? And it largely has to do, at least in my opinion, with computers, computing capacity, and storage capacity. If you just look at what's happening with computing power over time, we as humans have seen an exponential growth of computing power over time. It's not linear, it's truly exponential. And you see where we're at here up on a steeper end of this curve. And this is gonna continue to grow and grow. And if you look at what's predicted in 2045 with regards to computing power, it's predicted that computers at that time are gonna surpass the brain power equivalent to all human brains combined. And that's pretty powerful and even almost difficult to comprehend. But that is where we are going with what computers are able to do. And you couple that with connectivity with the internet and even with capacity to store that data, we're at a pretty powerful time to use AI and machine learning as we carry this forward. Now, a lot of what we're talking about in this session, in this course, in this meeting is around machine learning. But you've got to remember that artificial intelligence is much more than just machine learning. Machine learning is an important part of it, but it also encompasses searching, planning, reasoning, and proposition. And when we look at machine learning, there's various types as well that I'm sure our other speakers will cover. I think what we're most comfortable with is supervised learning, right? Where we control the model, we control the data, and we can look at the data on the other end. So it's a much more controlled form of machine learning and artificial intelligence. But there's unsupervised learning, which is maybe the more exciting area here, where the computer sort of knows what we want to get out of it and continues to learn and modify and does it in a much more autonomous way moving forward. And that's probably where we're going towards the future, towards truly autonomous machine learning with AI platforms. Now, why spine? As I mentioned, I want to give a broader view of this. Why apply any of this technology into the field of spine care? And I think this slide sums it up. What we do is incredibly expensive, right? This is an estimate of about $110 billion of direct costs to the United States into spine care, from spine care every year. Now, what I will sort of hypothesize here is a lot of that spend is very wasteful. And I'm going to show you as reasons that are going to be obvious why a lot of what we do is probably unneeded. We have no idea if it's effective. And I'm not talking about surgery. I'm talking about maybe what we do before surgery. And even the surgeries that we do, right? We're all over the map with the kind of procedures we do, the indications amongst ourselves and our own institution across the US. And that costs a significant amount of money, and that's not real value. And this puts a big crosshairs on our back with regards to us being spine surgeons and spine docs. And this is really why we need something like AI and machine learning to help us do this better and to provide more value to our patients, to our institutions, and to society as a whole. We know that our reimbursements are also declining. So if we want to keep all of ourselves in business, our hospitals in business, and be able to provide the care that we want to provide to patients, we've got to be more efficient, more effective, and innovate our way through this. Simply doing more procedures in an area with declining reimbursement is just not something that's going to be viable looking forward into the future. Now, as I mentioned, what we do in spine is heterogeneous, right? We don't indicate patients very effectively. Again, this is how I think AI will help us, but here's an illustration of the problem. These are two studies that we published here out of Cleveland Clinic from our spine research group looking at the treatment of two common pathologies. One is recurrent lumbar disc herniation, the second one being low back pain. We sent out a survey to a number of both ortho and neuro board certified surgeons across the country and just asked them how they would treat these scenarios, giving them options on how to treat that. And look at the degree of disagreement we saw amongst these board certified spine surgeons, almost 70% with regards to recurrent lumbar disc herniation and 75% amongst those with low back pain. And we consider ourselves the experts, yet the vast majority of us can't even agree on what procedure, if any, we would offer these patients. And so again, you can see how this much disagreement results in a large disparity in the type of surgery we do and a large disparity in the number of surgeries we do, and that's going to impact our outcome and also our costs. Now, what about here at Cleveland Clinic? I'm going to give you some specific look at what we do and how this has impacted us. The what I've laid out in the past has illustrated the problem, right? We're heterogeneous, our outcomes are variable, our costs continue to rise despite dropping reimbursement, and we've got to be innovative. So in 2015, here at Cleveland Clinic, we set out a vision to set up a platform to try to innovate through this. So we wanted to use AI to transform our spine service line. We wanted to do that to improve our cost, improve our outcome and decrease our cost, which is really value if you put that into an equation. And then our thought is we could leverage this platform if we were able to do this. We could leverage it with payers, with primary employers to try to obtain better contracting that allow us to be more value-based, right? Maybe do less. We don't have to continue to drive volume. We could do less, but still maintain profitability. Now, why? What do we see here at Cleveland Clinic is we continue to see a drop in reimbursement year over year, right? We continue to see a drop in our realization rates year over year, and there's no reason to think that this is going to change moving forward. And despite that, we continue to do lots of surgery. So the idea is, from our institution has been, well, reimbursement's dropping, you got to just continue to do more surgeries so we can keep up with that drop. And this is 2019 data, and what we did in 2020 was actually 4,000 cases. So we continue to drive volume to try to make up for the dropping reimbursement. The problem is this is not sustainable, right? So if you just have a graph of sort of our procedures, and this can be, you know, you can think about this being profitability over time. It's not a linear line around procedures you can do, right? It does become somewhat logarithmic. But again, we continue to try to drive our profitability by volume, by procedures, surgeries, injections, patients we see. And again, you do have to note this is not value-based care, right? This is volume-based care, right? But we end up hitting sort of a max, right? You get to a point where you can't simply do more in a world of dropping reimbursement, right? There's only so much hours in the day people can work. There's only so many operating rooms that can be open to the daytime. So you do have a maximum amount of work you can do. And if you continue working in the same model for dropping reimbursements, then your profitability is going to continue to decline. So you're actually working backwards here, and the curve is bending downwards, right? You're going to have people burn out. They're going to leave. Reimbursement's dropping. Your faculty disengage. It may have an impact on patient engagement. Research and education take a hit here because all you're doing is working. So the model you're on, which is just drive volume, is not sustainable. So we figured we've got to innovate here, right? We've got to change what we do so we could bend this curve upwards and continue to do the good work we do without having to just do it in such a crazy pace. Now, obviously, the other way to do it is to downsize, but nobody wants to downsize and lay people off. So we really want to try to innovate through that. So let's get back to the idea of heterogeneity. So why use an AI platform? Well, we talked about our outcomes are variable. But let me give you another more specific example of that variability, which maybe we don't often consider. One is, let's consider these six patients. All six of these patients have a grade 1 L4-5 spondylolisthesis, spinal stenosis, and neurogenic claudication. So if you think about a standard, I don't know, registry or indication, you know, maybe all of these patients are offered a fusion and a laminectomy. But let's look at how this is more complicated, right? These six patients are all different, right? They all have different values. They have different education. They have different expectations. They all access and use the healthcare system differently. Couple that with, this is basing this on 13 surgeons, couple that with 13 different spine surgeons that may see this one patient. They all have different values. They all have different training. They all have different tools in their toolbox to treat them. So if you just consider that factor, we think about these patients all being the same when we look at them just as a procedure or just as a pathology, but they're different. Our surgeons are different. So if you factor that, there's no wonder why our outcomes are all over the map, right? We have variable outcome measures, we have variable costs based on all of this, including the patient. Our reimbursements are different based on that. So again, this has a huge impact on us as a healthcare system, but you can also imagine if you're the payer and you're looking at this heterogeneity in both outcome and cost, to them, this is a major risk, right? So they are often very nervous to come in and say contract with you with a favorable rate, as an example, because you can't give them a homogeneous outcome. You can't give them a homogeneous cost. And we can't simply do that in the current model we're in, right? There's no way to match this, all of this up in a way, in a simple way we do it now by sitting in an office and examining a patient moving forward. Again, this is how I think a big data approach allows to do this in a more effective way. So again, we talked about the many variables involved, right? High number of surgeons in a big healthcare system by us. We see a ton of pathology. There's a significant number of operations, even for the same pathology. And there's all kinds of non-surgical treatments out there with the same pathology. The patients all have different variables. Sometimes we don't even know what they are and don't collect them. And again, we're living in a volume fee-for-service world. Couple that with, if you just think about this, look at the guidelines from our societies, the ABOS and the ABNS guidelines for treating spine patients with operative intervention. I mean, what does it really tell us? It tells us, well, patients have to have 6 weeks of non-op care. Like, who even scientifically showed that, right? You got to have failure of non-op regimen or intractable pain. I mean, that's it, right? Hit those three measures and go ahead and take somebody into surgery, right? No wonder that our costs are high and our outcomes are heterogeneous when this is really all that's really out there. And it's not even based in sound science. Data that comes out of this. This is our data at Cleveland Clinic taking 1 and 2 level laminectomy for neurogenic claudication. And this is looking at promised physical health scores, just outlining the problem with actual data. So this is preoperative, right? So if we're all indicating surgeon or patients fairly equivalently across our health system, these should be clustered fairly close together. And there's a huge spread of patients here with regards to their physical function scores or physical health scores, right? So you would think we would do a much better job of being more homogeneous on who we select for surgery. And what's more scary is look at their one-year outcome and look at the spread of points here, right? The patients are all over the map with regards to how they do, and with only 60% of them reaching their MCID with regards to improvement on the physical health score of promise. So this is illustrating the problem in real time in a very high-end spine center. We're not indicating patients very well, and we're doing a ton of different operations, and we're not quite sure why we have such a heterogeneous group of outcomes in that patient population. I use these just to illustrate the problem. So our idea was then to use a big data approach to try to do this better. And this is really where AI has come into place, right? It's to take the data that we have from patients, right? And we can get that patient extracted from Epic. It's demographic data. It could be how they interact with the healthcare system, their socioeconomic status, et cetera, you name it. And big data, it doesn't matter why. It's really just what. So we just want to collect as much data as we can. We can extract data from our finance system, and we can take all of our outcome data that we have, and then we can horizontally integrate that data, okay, and apply it through big data analytics and through machine learning and AI and have a predictive analytical tool that we can use in real time to better indicate patients and to help describe who should have surgery, what type of surgery, and potentially who should be doing the surgery moving forward. And this gives us really good operational knowledge and really that prescriptive ability with a very specific patient to drive what we do, where we do it, and even who we should do it on. And our goal here was really, as I mentioned, if we could do this and validate it, that is really the value proposition, right? Now, our outcomes should be much more homogeneous. More importantly, they should be predictable, right? Because we're predicting how someone's going to do. We should be able to do it at a lower cost. This really helps us with population health. We can leverage this with payers and primary employed healthcare providers. what I think is very fascinating is we can automate this moving forward. So it, maybe it's more than just a predictive analytical tool. And I'll show you in the next slide how that may work. Certainly it's going to give us a competitive advantage. We'll be able to grow. Since we're not asking people just to do more and more surgeries, we can have better engagement with our healthcare providers. And we have some operational freedom, right? Our margins are shrinking. If we drop down a little bit, it's always the ask is to do more. Well, if we can do less, but we can do it better, we have operational freedom and we're all happier. Our engagement scores may continue to rise and we're much more satisfied in our job. Now, I mentioned data. It's a big data approach. What data we're using? Think about all the data that's out there with our patients, right? It's not just what's in their outcomes, right? It's all of the data we get. And it's more than that. It may be how many MyChart messages they send or like email, how many phone calls, right? All of their imaging, right? All of the data that's out there, plus all their labs, their outcomes, et cetera, we can use this in our big data analytical approach in focusing on outcome and everything else with the patient. We created a beta as our AI tool. We originally called it HAL. It's no longer called HAL anymore, but you could go in and say, here's a patient. I want to do a lumbar laminectomy on this stenosis patient. This is the surgeon. This is one of my partners, Tom Moraz. And we can figure out with our AI tool what we want to be important, what outcomes we want to look at. And we can sort of figure out for each outcome measure we want to look at with, say, for Moraz in that patient with that operation, you know, can we predict they're going to hit their MCID with whatever outcome that we want? Will it be able to do it within the cost range that we want, et cetera? And we can use this and be able to determine, should we indicate this patient for surgery? Where should the location we do it at? And should surgeon Moraz be the one that do it as an example? And this is what we pulled out with our early AI predictive analytical tool. And the idea here was to use it real time, right? To embed this in our electronic medical record. So if I'm seeing the patient to the right with neurogenic claudication and lumbar stenosis, my big data approach is going to take all the variables that are available to us and be able to give us a prediction like, yep, I'm going to be able to do a nice job. I indicate this patient for surgery. He has an excellent percentage chance of improving. Maybe no, let's not do surgery, but maybe this patient's more appropriate for an injection. We can predict he'll do much better there. Or no, this patient should have any intervention in the spine world, and maybe we need to get them in for different care. And so the idea was to be that simple, have a tool that we can use in real time that takes all of the data available and spits out a predictive analytic. And we put that in place and it worked. We validated it internally and we're working on broadening that currently. It's not out live right now. We are continuing to work forward on that as we move forward. But what we're excited about is what this could look like even to a greater extent moving forward, right? So what if we took our AI platform and really used it for automation? So it's not just a predictive analytical tool, which is what we want from the surgical, the interventional platform. We know it can do that. But what else could it do on an automated fashion? Imagine I operated on somebody that I was appropriately indicated for, and they interact with our app, with the EMR. And the app, it's a chat bot, so it's not a human. So it's a chat bot that sounds just like a human to the patient. And the chat bot picks up the patient's having severe pain or maybe having dysphagia. That triggers an AI. It's learning this, right? To an automatic call to maybe the resident on call to call the patient back. It calls in a medication automatically to the pharmacy, and all of this interaction comes back to the patient. You have very little human interaction, but the patient's appropriately cared for, you prevent complications, and the patient's much more happy and engaged with that. Imagine I schedule surgery, right? And through AI, it knows the surgery that I'm doing, and it automatically everything I'm going to need postoperatively, all the medications, physical therapy, all the appointments, it schedules the surgery all on its own so that my nurse can do something else during the day that's more effective with patient-facing care. And again, so this is improving engagement for the patient. It's an automated process, much more efficient and effective. It takes down on human time to be able to do that. And it should be allow us to be much more effective and efficient with what we do and much more predictable. So in summary, why we can look at computing or why we can look at AI and machine learning now and use it. The data is available across multiple platforms. It's not just the EMR. It's what the patient searches on the internet. It's the finance data, the outcome data. Now we have the computer capacity to be able to use this in such a big data analytical approach. And it's expanding exponentially. It's only going to get better. AI is going to transform medicine. I'm confident of that. It's going to be in every aspect of medicine moving forward, and it'll change the way we practice. And I think for the better. We know it's transforming society currently, right? Think about everything that's out there that uses an AI platform, Alexa, self-driving cars, drones that the military uses for surveillance, AI or Google Translate. There's so many examples out there that have just changed our lives, and it's going to continue to get better moving forward, and we're going to see it more and more in medicine. I'm very excited in spine, especially on the predictive analytical side of the AI platforms that are out there. It's going to improve patient care in disease natural history across specialties. I want to thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to the rest of the presentations during this course. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael. We're now going to take the second of our two breaks. We'll be resuming our lectures in about 4 minutes. I'm now going to transfer hosting duties back over to Dave Briggs in our exhibition hall to introduce our next sponsor for this evening's course. Dave?
Our second sponsor this evening is Globus Medical, who has a comprehensive robotic navigation platform that will work with any imaging system. For anyone interested in more information about these comprehensive robotic navigation systems, please follow the link posted in the Zoom chat function. And back to our lecture hall, Dr. Chang.
Thank you, Dave. Our next presentation is from Dr. Danny Goyle, Clinical Associate Professor at the University of British Columbia and CEO of Precision OS. He will be sharing some of the cutting-edge uses of virtual reality in surgical training. Thanks for joining us today, Danny.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chang, and thank you, Robin, for the opportunity to present a little bit about virtual reality and how it impacts robotics training. My disclosure is, as mentioned, I'm a founder and CEO of Precision OS, and most of what I'm going to present is related to robotics and the education of such a new technology. So if we look at our surgeon training model, the question that we're asking is there an adjunct to this method of learning? We're all familiar with robotics onboarding. You do require a period of learning. The first exposure usually is through a lab, and we know this can be quite cost intensive. And so the challenge, of course, for this type of model, at least from the pre-robotic in the OR state, is that when you expose a surgeon or surgeons to the actual technology, that the hands-on training is quite expensive and it's actually not widely available. So how do you expose a larger audience to a new technology, in this case, robotics? And importantly, what is the educational impact of that cadaveric learning? So COVID, of course, has brought this to the forefront, at least the technology from both a virtual reality perspective, as well as AR, which was mentioned earlier with some very nice talks. Now, the issue really is, I think at the end of the day, the confidence piece is really important. That's what's going to drive confidence in adopting and using a technology like robotics. Typically, what we do see, though, is that there's a circular modality here where confidence drives more confidence and vice versa. But the issue is does confidence always equal confidence? So when we looked at the data on cadaveric learning, this is a meta-analysis that was done just a few years ago, looking at 75 years of cadaveric simulation for surgical training. And they isolated 51 studies, 9 of which were in orthopedics. And the mean Mirsky score, which is an index of the quality and impact of educational research, was quite low, which is actually 9.4. When I look deeper at this data, this is a Kirkpatrick hierarchy for how you assess educational research and the impact that it has on patient outcomes. At the top of this triangle is how cadaveric simulation has shown to have direct patient outcomes, and I'll go over the studies in each of these tiers. At the bottom is where surgeons actually felt confident or competent after doing a cadaveric assessment. Most studies reported this as a primary outcome, i.e. the surgeons felt confident after doing this type of modality. When they assessed whether or not cadaveric learning actually had an impact on their knowledge, that was only 5 studies. When they compared cadavers to simulation, there was 4 studies, and the studies actually show that the results were actually quite mixed on evaluation of behavior, i.e. change in skill. There was only 1 study that actually demonstrates that cadaver learning and education actually has a direct impact on patient outcomes. That was an ICU study, which actually looked at intubation and chest tube insertion. And the reason that had a direct impact is because you could repeat the event over and over again, intubation and chest tube insertion, and then also assess your outcome, i.e. was there a penetration in the lung, or was there lacerations in the mouth or broken teeth with intubation? So the question, of course, is, you know, the theme of this talk today is, what is the goal of robotics? The goal of robotics is to design machines that actually help and assist humans. And I'm going to focus on the orthopedic literature. And of course, many of you have probably seen this video here, which is, you know, this is an actual robot created by Boston Dynamics, just to show you how, you know, the technology is advancing very, very rapidly, and there was a really good presentation done on Augmented. But where is this technology going, and how should we be thinking about this as it relates to orthopedic specialties, spine included? So one of the things that's a common debate, and the debate continues, is what is the impact to outcomes of robotic-assisted, and I've chosen total knees here, on outcomes? And this is a single surgeon study done out of Singapore. Now, key points to note here is they noted no difference in outcomes. Now, these are outcomes that are noted after only 6 months. This was a high volume surgeon who did achieve 120 plus arthroplasties per year. Things to note of this particular study was that they identified that the same OR time was carried out in both the robotics group and the conventional group. One thing that's really important to note here is a surgeon without the robotics platform actually had a joint life shift of 20% of his cases, compared to in the robotics assisted surgery of 3.2%. And this was only 6 months. So the conclusion, I would say, is not complete. We haven't, when we talk about the continuum of care, how, when do you end the continuum of care when you try to value an introduction of a platform like robotics? This is a second study showing a very similar thing, that there's no difference in outcomes or long-term survivorship of robotic assisted in a surgeon who completed both a robotics knee as well as a conventional knee. Now, this was a single surgeon. They measured outcomes over the course of 8 years. This was a surgeon that did 250 joints per year. So the question that we should be asking is this the audience that should be using robotic surgery if there is truly no difference in this particular case? Now, to give you some perspective on the hip and knee literature as it relates to robotics, this is a study out of New York that looked at a 500% increase of robotic-assisted joint replacements between 2009 and 2013. And they cite some really interesting barriers to adoption. Cost of robotics, again, but we have to define that continuum of care of how do we define and when do we define the primary endpoints of value. So to give you some perspective, if you were to say a robot costs $1 million, if over the next 3 years a surgeon prevented 10 complications, that robot paid for itself. Other issues that actually are barriers to adoption are increased operative times. Again, and the barriers that were noted were technical challenges, specifically related to registration, and a learning curve of between 15 to 35 cases. Now, if I am proposing that if robotics are really good for low volume surgeons, and low volume surgeons equals that they do 50 cases or less a year, and the learning curve for this may take up to 6 months or maybe longer, perhaps a year. How do you mitigate against that if we think that there's value in robotic surgery? So what if robotics education followed learning principles? What if it was safe? What if it was hands-on and provided deliberate practice on demand and actually allowed you to interact with a learner or an expert from anywhere in the world, anytime? And again, who is the target audience for robotics implementation in orthopedics? So virtual reality, for those of you who may not have exposure to this, is a computer-generated simulation where someone can interact with someone else or an object in a three-dimensional, complete digital environment. This is the hardware you need. There's no personal computer, there's no wires, and it weighs less than a pound. Now, this is the fidelity that you can achieve in virtual reality. You could teach somebody how to do registration, how to address the technical challenges, as mentioned earlier, about the barriers to adoption. And you could do things like drill bones or saw bones. You can bring in the entire robotic suite, and you can engage in a way that actually you can't do at an appropriate time relative to when your first case would be. Now, when we studied VR in senior residents, we noted some very interesting findings. So this is a study published in JBJS where we compared surgeons doing a procedure in VR versus surgeons doing that same procedure, reading it through a peer-reviewed paper. On the left is a time of training. So the light blue is the VR group. The dark blue is the standard PDF or peer-reviewed group. The end point for the study was safe dissection where they could proceed to the next point of the procedure. And you can see with the amount of input, there was significantly less output in the PDF group compared to the VR group. We repeated the study showing video learning. So in the light blue is the time it took to do VR for an actual instrumentation of a particular procedure, in this case, which was a shoulder. And you can see their technical performance on the cadaver was far superior than the video learning group, which is in the dark blue. What was interesting to note here is the non-VR group or the video learning group actually made 50%, or sorry, the VR group made 50% less critical errors than the non-VR group. And what was even more important to note here, we talked about confidence and competence, is that there's similar confidence in both groups before they actually went to the cadaveric evaluation. So to summarize, I think we have a technology here that does provide hands-on experience. It can impact appropriate and timely learning curves. And it may address this significant issue of what I've quoted here as saying time-appropriate surgical education. If you do a lab today, but your first robotics case isn't for a month or 6 weeks from now, you can be guaranteed that you have lost that skill acquisition, those notes, that mental memory, that physical memory that you established in the lab. Peer-to-peer engagement, and then of course, team-based training, because no robotics platform is without its technical challenges that all the people in the operating room need to know about to drive efficiency. And of course, surgical education, we've all seen, surgeons can be able to continue in the face of pandemic. How do you do that anytime, anywhere? And at least with what I've shown here, VR does have the possibility to potentially impact at least two of the major barriers to robotics adoption. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Danny, for sharing your presentation and those videos. Our last presentation tonight before our live Q&A session will be from Simran Madani, Senior Associate at MICRA, with current concepts in robotics and AI reimbursement. Thanks for joining us, Simran.
Everyone, thank you for inviting me to speak today. My name is Simran Madani, and I'm a Senior Associate at MICRA here in Washington, D.C. My work has been focused on researching the reimbursement environment and developing successful commercial strategies for products in a variety of different therapeutic areas. So today we'll be discussing the current reimbursement landscape for artificial intelligence and the use of robotics in multiple therapy areas. We will also touch upon what the future reimbursement landscape may look like. So let's begin with an overview of healthcare reimbursement. When we look at reimbursement, we are really looking at three distinct entities: coverage, coding, and payment. Each of these entities, however, are interrelated. Coverage determines whether the device is eligible to be paid, coding is a method of documenting the device, and payment is the actual reimbursement of the device. The most important aspect is coverage. The real work begins after a device gets FDA approval. If the coverage landscape for a particular device is negative, it will not matter if there is an existing coding or payment methodology. At this point, the device would not be eligible to be paid. Evidence generation is key to pursuing a positive reimbursement landscape. Positive coverage requires scientific evidence that clearly shows the positive impact the new and novel device has on the patient population it is intended for. So let's take a more in-depth look at what exactly the coverage evaluation criteria is. Commercial payers and Medicare have very different technology evaluation criteria. Medicare looks at three things. Is it safe and effective? Is it approved and not experimental? And is it intended for the Medicare population? Commercial payers, on the other hand, have much more detailed requirements. The device must be FDA approved. The scientific evidence must permit conclusions concerning the effect of the technology on health outcomes. It must improve net health outcomes. It must be as beneficial as established alternatives, and the improvement must be attainable outside of an investigational setting. This criteria is used by many payers to determine whether or not they should cover a technology. New and novel devices usually do not have enough scientific literature to document long-term impacts of their technology, and then the impacts on net health outcomes. For this reason, many technologies end up on experimental investigational lists when they first come to market. And until more data is available, they're able to satisfy the second and third criteria, they will be denied for coverage. So looking at artificial intelligence specifically, the FDA has been approving many AI technologies in recent years. Unfortunately, though, Medicare and commercial payers have been apprehensive to providing positive coverage and payment. There is no doubt that AI will disrupt and positively revolutionize the medical industry, but innovation is unfortunately going to outpace reimbursement methodologies. We will talk through a few examples, but let's look at the landscape from a bird's eye view first. Currently, there is no coverage policies that are specific to AI technology. There are, however, AI-specific codes to document the technology, and some codes even have payment assignments. Absent coverage policies, each patient claim will be reviewed on a case-by-case basis, and payment will only be granted if it's medically necessary to use the new technology or the new device. There are, however, ongoing discussions on whether Medicare has a benefit category that properly identifies AI and digital health technologies. If there's no benefit category, then services may be excluded from coverage. It is, however, reassuring to see Medicare encouraging innovation. So they started a new program called the Artificial Intelligence Health Outcomes Challenge, and they're awarding up to $1 million to the winner of this program. They had around 300 applications to first start the program. They narrowed it down to 7, and we should be hearing about a winner soon. On the commercial side, there are negative coverage policies for AI-powered lab tests due to the lack of scientific literature. As we'll see on the next slide, even if a product has a code assignment and an associated payment assignment, coverage is still a barrier to adoption. In September 2020, CMS granted VIS-LBO the first new technology add-on payment in an inpatient setting for artificial intelligence software. New technology add-on payment is an additional payment on top of the payment that the facility already receives to accommodate the costs incurred for adopting new and novel technologies. The technologies must meet the newness criteria, which means that it must not be substantially similar to anything else on the market. It must provide substantial clinical improvement over existing technologies, and it has to meet a specified cost threshold as well. This is the first AI technology to show substantial clinical evidence to support NTAP payment. The software specifically demonstrated a significant reduction in time and treatment and improved clinical outcomes to patients suffering from a stroke. Commercial payers are silent on this technology, so every patient case will be determined for medical necessity, and it'll be done by a case-by-case review. In contrast, though, IDXDR can be found on commercial payers' experimental and investigational lists. So even though IDXDR received the first permanent code assignment for autonomous AI, there is no positive coverage for the procedure on the commercial side. Furthermore, there wasn't enough data to support a payment assignment, so payment is also carrier priced, meaning that if the procedure was eligible to be paid, it would be up to the payer, whether Medicare or commercial, to determine the payment value. Medicare did say that they're going to continue to gather information from stakeholders on the appropriate cost for this service, so we're hoping to see more payment modifications in the future. But overall, Medicare is specifically encouraging innovation, and the more clinical data that becomes available to support the value proposition for AI technology, the more positive changes we'll see in the current reimbursement landscape. The robotics landscape, however, is a bit more structured, and the burden on adopting the new technology rests mostly on the facility side. The use of robotics is considered a technique to conducting a surgery. For this reason, there's no additional payment for the use of robotics in the operating room. The decision to use the robot rests entirely on the surgeon and the facility, and payment will be based on the primary procedure with no additional payment. From Medicare's perspective, though, if the procedure is medically necessary and it's carried out by a Medicare contracted surgeon and a facility, then it should be approved for payment. Commercial payers follow the same methodology. If the surgeon or facility chooses to use the robotic technique, reimbursement will be based on the primary procedure's payment. Taking Medtronic's Mazor platform, for example, guidance during spinal fusion procedures is not mentioned in commercial policies. In this case, the facility would assess the value of the technology and choose to adopt it or not adopt it. The payment will still be based on the primary spinal fusion procedure, but because there's no additional payment for the use of a robotic technique, facilities will most likely ask the following questions. Does it save time in the operating room? Does it impact the quantity of procedures I can perform? Does it result in better patient outcomes? And does it reduce the total procedure costs? Once the hospital's value analysis committee has analyzed the answers to these questions, they will then decide whether or not using a robotic technique would be beneficial for their facility and their patients. So both patient outcomes and costs come into play when choosing to adopt a technology from the facility side. In recent years, we have seen Medicare encourage innovation, and there have been measures taken to encourage facility and surgeon adoption of these new and novel therapies. We already discussed additional payment opportunities. But as we mentioned before, coverage is the most important roadblock to overcome for new and novel technologies. That being said, CMS recently issued a rule that seeks to expedite coverage for breakthrough devices. Breakthrough devices are devices that have been granted breakthrough status from the FDA specifically. These devices are usually new and novel devices that provide more effective treatment for diagnosis of life-threatening or debilitating diseases or conditions. CMS announced the Medicare Coverage of Innovative Technology Program to allow immediate positive coverage for these devices. Coverage would only last for 4 years from the date of FDA approval, but this short automatic coverage period allows patients to get access to the technology, but it also allows payers to track utilization and establish a payment down the line. While we expect MCIT to be implemented under the Biden administration, there was a regulatory hold put on any rule that has not taken effect yet. This MCIT rule did have bipartisan support for the rule, so we are keeping a close eye. It was supposed to be implemented March 15th, but we'll see what happens down the road. But we would expect it to pass. So in summary, the reimbursement landscape is not streamlined. Coverage, coding, and payment varies for every device. Innovation is outpacing coverage, coding, and payment methodologies as it currently stands. Relevant stakeholders will continue to look to clinical evidence to support their decisions for coverage and payment. Artificial intelligence is gaining momentum, and work is being done to create a positive reimbursement landscape. Medicare, thankfully, is acknowledging AI's value proposition, but commercial payers are still apprehensive to issuing positive commercial policies. The payment, however, is still not reflective of the expenses required to adopt AI technology. Similarly, robotics in the operating room is at the surgeon and facility's discretion. There is no additional payment adjustment for the use of robotics as a surgical technique. Commercial payers, however, have explicitly published negative coverage policies for the use of robotics as a means of treatment and not necessarily as a means of aiding the surgeon. There is still insufficient evidence that independent automated robotic treatment is safe and effective, but they're still silent on using robotics as an aid to the surgeon. For various programs encouraging innovation, including device development competitions, additional payment pathways, and automatic coverage opportunities, these programs encourage innovation, and it'll be many years until there's widespread adoption of artificial intelligence and robotic assistant devices, but we will see many changes in the next 10 to 15 years. Overall, innovation in artificial intelligence and robotics will outpace reimbursement methodologies, but the long-term data that does become available in the coming years will prove the safety, efficacy, and value of these innovative technologies. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Samram. That was an excellent presentation. Panelists, please turn on your videos as we move into our live Q&A session. Our chat function is now open for your questions.
Indeed, very exciting. Thank you. We have a ton of questions and we'll try to get through these as many of these as possible. The first question that I have is for Dr. Haboob. Gabe, can you comment on the importance of negative reinforcement, learning to teach the algorithms the importance of what to avoid? As a follow-on question, what percentage of positive versus negative feedback in your training sets?
So the negative reinforcement is definitely very negative component of the reward, very important reinforcement learning. And you can kind of tweak it to your demand. So if you want to penalize the algorithm significantly, you can drop that number to achieve that task. As far as what's the second question? Is the number of positive?
What percentage of positive versus negative feedback in your training sets?
So the real reinforcement learning is a little bit different from the way you handle it than like in the general learning methodology. So you don't have really the training and testing. You create what you do is an simulation environment from each patient, and it creates your algorithm based on that single simulation. And for each basically patient, you create a new algorithm. And at each action, basically, the environment you generate will give it some sort of a reward. So you can't really define as a kind of percentage of positive and negative from that perspective.
Great, thank you. Frank, Dr. Phillips, we got so many questions. This is what you described was exciting, and I picked up on one really key phrase. You were looking at the patient during your entire procedure, which I think is a very important aspect, particularly when talking about dangerous and procedural approaches in treating the spine, and something that from a navigation perspective, I think a lot of people felt from a resident training perspective, it was moving away from some of those very important aspects of those procedures. But come a long way from Google Glass. And the question that was posed is augmetics approved for cervical procedures? If not, why not? Frank, do we see Frank?
No, I don't think I see Frank.
I saw him a minute ago. Okay. Well, we'll move on to the next question. Dr. Theodore, great presentation. This was a question related to passive versus active. Obviously, in the US, it's a very litigious environment, as many people are very well aware. Do you see a need or move to more active robotic systems or active features that we, for example, compared to some of the things that we see from a robot assisted procedure in Europe? Do you see a need for that in the US market?
Well, I think the FDA has been pretty clear on sort of the controls, and thanks a lot for the question, Boyle, on the way the controls are set up and the safety features which are baked in through an FDA perspective are at this point fairly immovable. So the idea of having fully autonomous surgery or more autonomous surgery is a little science fiction still, but we're moving in that direction. And I think with each and every year that goes by, and the FDA is a little bit more realizing that some things can be automated if certain safety features are built in. But understand that the posture still at this point is that moves very slowly. So I think it's going to happen. It's just going to take time. And it will evolve as the technology evolves. As we've seen in a lot of these talks this evening, as the technology gets better in helping us do other things besides just put screws in and guide us, for bone cutting. So if you can take something like the Mako and make that into something that's more autonomous, I think that's going to happen. Maybe not during our careers because you and I have too much gray hair, but certainly at some point.
Excellent. Dr. Goyle, would you have anything else to add from your perspective?
From a virtual reality perspective?
Yes.
I mean, the big thing for VR is it's a really immersive technology that allows you to do things that you can't do in not only in the cadaver lab, but obviously in a patient scenario. So adding in different scenarios, allowing you to interact and expand your perceptual expertise. And spine is probably one of the most complex anatomical structures to three-dimensionally make a model in your mind of when you're looking at a fluoroscopy image. So are we 100% sure to augment robotics, we should also have a deeper understanding of the anatomy? And the way to learn that is an environment where you can actually immersively engage with the anatomy. So that's where VR is really valuable. And then you actually can deepen your perceptual expertise of the anatomy by doing things like landmarking a transverse process in the spine, taking a fluoro image in VR and then pulling the spine out of the back, which is what we offer in our platform. And I think so VR is still so early and there's so much we can do right now that the future is really untapped and the potential is massive.
But it brings us back into real time, which is fantastic. And what we love about that in layering on top of active robotic system. A question for Dr. Gum. Will we see a Louisville spine score based on the fantastic and rigorous data that was applied to your data set in comparison to some of the other spine scores out there? Any guarantees?
Yeah. So first, I definitely cannot take credit for that data. So it's a very robust data set. And that's it. You know, we combine ISSG data and ESSG data, which are, you know, two big deformity platforms. And we've been working on a deformity calculator. And honestly, although the data is there, the models there, the analytics is there, the barrier to a lot of these is how to implement them real time. And in my opinion, you know, we can take data, enter these data points, but that's an extra step that doesn't make sense in real life clinical situations. And so until we get these models to really go in and out of the EMR and several EMRs to where it calculates these risk calculators or risk adjustment scores real time, I don't think it's good for academics, it's good for study, it's good for altering things, but on a day-to-day basis, on a real-time decision-making, I think we needed a lot of progress of in and out of the EMR. And, you know, we use Epic. So what I would like to see is some sort of calculator that grabs all these data points and I don't have to enter them into anything. And I get scores based on a procedure proposed, et cetera. So definitely I cannot take credit for that. That won't be implemented in Louisville. I'm honored to be a part of that, those two big study groups and help with that. But I think in the future, as we get more elegant in and out of the EMR is when we're going to see these real time.
Excellent. One last question. I'll leave with Robin. What area of concern is data hacking? How prevalent is it and how can hospitals protect against these nefarious attacks?
Well, I just looked up the data, but between 2009 and 2020, we had 3,705 healthcare data breaches that affected 268 million patient health records. And so far this year, we've had 119 data breaches affecting about 9 million health records. And what makes me slightly not positive about the future in terms of health, the safety of the data, is we're moving pretty rapidly into an era of what I call integration. So we'll be integrating data-centric tools, robotics, big data sets, and so forth, and they'll be existing in other platforms like the cloud and so forth. And the more we get into an integration phase, sort of the world of intelligent objects, Internet of Things, the danger of hacking grows. So it's one of these big issues that somebody's going to make a lot of money solving, and it's sitting there waiting to be solved. Thank you.
Well, I think we can conclude by thanking our audience and the faculty. What great presentations. Also to the audience for spending your evening with us. I think this has been a fantastic opportunity for learning. I learned a ton. And as always, great to have everyone collectively on this meeting. So very appreciate good. It. Thank you all. And we'll see you at the next one.
Very good. Have a good night, everybody.
Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Robert.
Thank you. Thank you to all our speakers today for an excellent program. And most importantly, thank you to all our attendees for participating in this excellent masterclass. Our next accredited masterclass will be on the topic of innovations and pain management in May. It should be a very interesting course. I hope to see you all there. Goodbye.
To let you know, I can really shake them down.